Melinda presents this unabridged recording of History of Science, a Beginner's Guide, written by Sean F. Johnston and read by James Adams. Preface. Historical studies of science and technology have acquired immense importance since the Second World War, and especially over the past few decades. Science itself has grown exponentially to involve more activity within living memory than through its previous history. Academics, government policymakers, businesses, public interest groups, and scientists themselves increasingly recognize the crucial role these subjects have had in extending knowledge, driving economies, influencing opinion, and shaping culture. Science in the modern world is all-encompassing and contentious. Acronyms jostle for attention and comprehension in newspaper stories. GMOs, BSE, VCJD, WMD. We consume science in the films we watch, the electronic products we buy, and the medications we choose. Science subtly determines our perceptions and powers our lifestyles and longings. Aspects of what we recognize as science have been part of human cultures since prehistory, though. As these activities have impinged increasingly on the consciousness of scholars and the public, the history of science has attracted further attention and been applied to conflicting purposes. For the British philosopher William Hoole, writing during the early 19th century, science, and the people defined by his new term, scientists, had long provided the key factor behind intellectual advancement. His History of the Inductive Sciences, published in 1837, helped to launch a new discipline. From the Victorian era until the Great Depression, the history of science was marshalled to show the inevitability of material progress. And for both American and Soviet philosophers after the Second World War, the trajectory of science in their nations represented the superiority of their respective political systems. But according to the counterculture ideals of the late 1960s, the history of science revealed a long-standing linkage between scientific knowledge and military and corporate power. Historians today recognize science as a human activity responsible in large part for the culture that we have inherited. This book introduces both the history of science and the nature of the evolving discipline and explains why they matter in contemporary society. It seeks to provide a brief historical survey of science and its relationship to culture, and at the same time, to inculcate in its listeners an awareness of the changing definition of science and sensitivity to its historical interpretation. This traditionally has been a minefield for educators, with science students sometimes presuming that a history should reveal the progress or even moral improvement of humankind, and humanities students more often presuming tarnished or questionable ideals of what in the 20th century became a pervasive cultural activity. The tone of the book seeks to give a nuanced appraisal of the evolution of science and rational approaches to the natural world from prehistory to the present day, and its integration into the practices and goals of Western societies over the past three centuries in particular. At the same time, inevitably selective and limited in coverage, it explores the nature of academic knowledge by providing an overview of the evolving discipline of history of science. The received wisdom about past science has changed dramatically in the last generation. This short book seeks to chart those changing directions. I thank Marcia Filion of One World Publications, who invited me to write this book, my students who helped shape it, and my wife Libby and sons Daniel and Sam for their ideas and support. Chapter 1. Introduction. History of Science, Past and Present. What is history of science? You are listening to this book with expectations and maybe even unconscious assumptions. Today, more than ever, your assumptions may be different from those of others around you. More than other forms of history, the history of science has often been written with a purpose, but those purposes and the conclusions they cite are today increasingly questioned. Are you looking forward to hearing about geniuses and their life stories, about scientific breakthroughs and inevitable material progress through invention, about the challenging experiments, toil in the face of personal, institutional, or military adversity, and the ultimate triumph of the intellect, or, I hope, something more? History of science has been all these things, but today strives to be much more. Written by scientists, history can seem self-serving. By philosophers, it can suggest a logical trajectory that is far too clear in retrospect. This potential for misrepresentation can have undesired side effects. It can encourage unsustainable faith in science's achievements, or provoke unreasonable criticisms of the cases that do not meet the mark, and may deter even bright students from confidently considering science as an attainable career. But misrepresentation suggests that there is an accurate, objective, official version of the history of science to be told. Surely, a succession of precise and indisputable facts will reveal how and why science developed in the way it did. Careful detailing of events is unquestionably important, and historians of science have ever more carefully explored the circumstances surrounding episodes of discovery and invention. But describing large-scale events and their causes is contentious, particularly in broad surveys like this one. Which facts are significant? Which historical personages matter? From the early 19th century, for example, Isaac Newton, 1642 to 1727, came to represent in Britain an icon of exceptional and unrivaled genius. In his shadow were others arguably worthy of attention too, his contemporary Robert Hooke, 1635 to 1703, who advanced microscopy and other experimental sciences, and Newton's rival, Gottfried Leibniz, 1646 to 1716, deviser of a more powerful version of calculus. Later scholarship revealed that Newton, as eventual head of the Royal Society, had played an important role in vaunting his own status in England, and in the 1930s, some two centuries after his death, historians began to turn their attention to his vast studies of alchemy and biblical scholarship, neither of which are categorized as science today, but to which Newton devoted equally meticulous attention and probably more of his time. The result was a more nuanced portrait of a complex man. Nevertheless, the pursuit of great thinkers has been a common thread in history of science. They can serve as models to emulate or to be nurtured. Accounts of exceptional individuals also encourage us to see intellectual development as sparks of inspiration, or, to use a term first popularized during the First World War, as breakthroughs that are asserted to be the inevitable result of concerted brain power. We cannot blame a lack of historical facts for these often misguided popular visions. Albert Einstein, 1879 to 1955, is today an icon of scientific genius, but his latter decades of relatively unproductive science, his role as supporter of left-of-center causes, and his love affairs are less well known and yet significant to his life's work. And a more recent example still, the American physicist Richard Feynman, 1918 to 1988, has been cast in popular histories of science as a quirky genius, imbued with a unique creativity and wholly unlike his contemporaries. Do such depictions capture the essence of their lives? Do such extraordinary individuals typify or contradict the development of science? Originally seeking to document intellectual advance, history of science has, for over 200 years, often been closely associated with philosophy and questions of how knowledge gets refined. The French philosopher Auguste Comte, 1798 to 1857, understood science as an intellectual and historical process. He argued, in ways that would raise the hackles of many scholarly communities today, that mathematical sciences represented the culmination of intellectual progress, carrying humankind from what he and many European contemporaries saw as primitive superstitions and animism to monotheistic theology, both seen as fictitious proto-theories, to metaphysical abstract, and then to what he called positive knowledge itself. His vision of inexorable advance via hard-nosed scientific methods won converts into the 20th century and provides the skeletal rationale for some practicing scientists today. With the rise of history of science as an increasingly recognized profession in the 20th century, some of the assumptions about genius and progress were questioned. Scientists, philosophers, and historians increasingly diverged in their views. When examined in detail, intellectual change seemed often to depend on factors that had been neglected. American philosopher of science Thomas Kuhn, 1922 to 1996, in his seminal text, The Structure of Scientific Revolutions, 1962, argued that battling for scientific theories involved not just important facts, but also the perceptions of scientific communities supporting them. Others, like British broadcaster and historian James Burke, born in 1936 and still alive today, in his ruminations in the television series Connections, 1978, went so far as to suggest that scientific advance and technological change were quixotic flukes, an unpredictable and unenlightening series of fortuitous juxtapositions of people, places, and insights. Bracketed by Comte and Burke 150 years apart, history of science might seem irrelevant. Why study its history if scientific advance was almost preordained on the one hand, or completely meaningless and unforecastable on the other? One reason is that historians and others remained fascinated by the complex episodes, their profound human consequences, and attempts to explain their trajectory. A more relevant motivation was that philosophers, sociologists, and historians from the 1970s began to focus on the broader factors involved in creating new knowledge at every scale, ranging from the organization of laboratories to public perceptions to national politics. What had captured attention nearly 200 years earlier as a straightforward and inspirational illustration of humankind's progressive drive has become a rich territory for wide-ranging disciplines. What is science? As more reasons for studying the history of science were identified, the foundations themselves came under increasing examination. Historians have been apt to adopt broad, inclusive definitions of their subject. Even modern descriptions cover a lot of ground. As defined by the Oxford English Dictionary, 2nd edition, 1989, for example, science includes knowledge acquired by study, or a recognized department of learning concerned with demonstrated truths or observed facts systematically classified, along with trustworthy methods for the discovery of new truths. And in a narrower sense, the OED defines its modern usage as branches of study that relate to the phenomena of the material universe and their laws. Not all of these components are necessarily essential for our purposes. Dictionaries tend to be heavily weighted towards contemporary usage. But within these dry and seemingly straightforward phrases are hidden dimensions that will be at the heart of this book. What sort of study, for example, has been employed, and indeed what kind of knowledge is produced? How have truths been demonstrated, and by whom, for what audiences? How are facts best observed and classified, and how have trustworthy methods been developed? and are the answers to these questions obvious to all or contentious? Shaking off the firm convictions of the Victorians, the term science began to appear increasingly uncertain as a term during the 20th century, and a timeless definition now seems inadequate. During one relatively brief period over the 16th to 18th centuries, profound changes in scientific knowledge and practice occurred, resulting in historians such as Herbert Butterfield, 1900 to 1979, popularizing the term the scientific revolution. For others, such as physicist and philosopher Pierre Duhem, 1861 to 1916, the modern form of science began in the late 12th century, with earlier activities described as pre-scientific. More recent scholarship, for example by historian Stephen Shapin, born in 1943 and still alive today, has questioned the amount of discontinuity during the revolution. Some aspects of careful observation and rational explanation can be traced back much further. As I will try to show, the scope and content of science have changed century by century, not just in terms of what we know, but also how and what we choose to study and what we include within it. The shifting boundaries are important in this. Defining what science is can also be aided by seeking a consensus about what science is not. As historians have demonstrated, but few science textbooks attest, the borders of science have been repeatedly challenged and adjusted. On one side lies science, and on the other, pseudoscience, a field that fails to live up to contemporary norms. Examples abound and can be important to philosophers and sociologists to explain how new knowledge is assessed and validated and how new sciences come to be. Take phrenology, for example. During the early 1790s, Franz Josef Gall, 1758 to 1828, devised his new system of brain anatomy and categorization in Vienna. He argued that portions of the human brain were responsible for particular intellectual attributes and that their relative size was reflected by the shape of the skull. A decade later, accompanied by J.G. Sporzim, Gall developed his ideas and undertook a successful lecture tour throughout Europe. By 1815, this would-be science of phrenology was attracting harsh criticisms from elite medical journals, but attracted further public attention and spurred middle-class men to take up phrenology as a scientific pursuit. Phrenological societies and subject journals, modeled on existing scientific journals, proliferated from the 1820s. The Phrenological Association first met in 1838, mimicking the British Association for the Advancement of Science, from which the phrenologists had been excluded. This professional interest was reflected in popular culture. By mid-century, novelists such as Mark Twain in Huckleberry Finn and Gustave Flaubert in Madame Bovary were referring to phrenological ideas. Despite such popular interest, phrenology failed to become an established science and gradually found itself simplified and sidelined by the end of the century as a contentious technique to identify born criminals and to classify human races, and later to associations with sideshow mind readers. Threads of these ideas nevertheless influence turn-of-the-century anthropology and 20th-century neuroscience. Was this an unjustly persecuted science? Many phrenologists were convinced of it. They cited a clear set of scientific claims, including that the mind is composed of distinct, innate faculties, and that the shape of the brain is determined by the development of the various organs, and hence, as the skull takes its shape from the brain, the surface of the skull can be read as an accurate index of psychological aptitudes and tendencies. By contrast, their first critics argued that phrenologists were not trained medical.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.